put together. You were talking about the mechanics of how the gold market is rigged, et cetera. Can you talk about that for the global audience, for anyone who may have missed it?
Well, it's I can try. Yes, it's the easiest if you have the article in front of you, Eric, because it shows the supply and demand graphs that prove the point. But what we do know about gold and silver is that the demand for possession of the physical metal, you know, for the actual gold and silver bullion, is extremely high and has been very high for some time and has been growing strongly. We also know that there are supply constraints because we know, for example, that right now, currently, as we talk, the U.S. Mint has had to suspend sales of silver eagles because it can't meet the demand. It can't get enough silver to mint the coins to meet the demand for them. And this is the second time in the last 9 months, previously was last November, that the U.S. Mint had to suspend sales of silver coins because it couldn't meet the demand. We know that for the first 5 months of this year, the U.S. Mint had to ration the sales of the coins. And Reuters, the news agency, reported that since the year 2013, the U.S. Mint has had to ration sales of silver eagles 18 months, which is almost the entire period. And we see the same thing in Canada, where Canada had to ration the sales of silver maple leaves, where Canada reports that the sales of their silver and gold maple leaves are very strong and rising. And if we just look at the last quarter in Canada, the sales of their coins were up 8.5% over the previous quarter. We see massive withdrawals from the GLD Gold Trust in the United States. We see massive sales from the Shanghai Gold Exchange. We see that India's imports in the first quarter of this year of silver is up 30%. Wherever you look, you see a massive demand for hands-on gold and silver, for the real stuff. It's everywhere. And yet we know that the mints can't meet this demand. We know that the mines output is falling because, for mysterious reasons, the price is falling. And so the mines can't cover their production cost at the lower price, and they cut back. So here is the mystery for an economist, for the law of supply and demand. We have massive increase in demand, which means the price should be extremely high. We have supply constraints, which means the price should be high. And yet, what have we seen since, for example, 2011, when the price of gold went over $1,900 an ounce? What we've seen is consistently falling prices for gold and silver for the last 4 years. How can this be? How can prices fall when demand is rising and supply is constrained? Well, in economics, they can't. It's an impossibility. It can't happen. So the only explanation is manipulation. And here's how the manipulation works. The price of gold and silver is not determined in the market where you go and buy the stuff. It's determined in a futures market where paper contracts representing gold and silver are traded, but the contracts are settled in cash. And so it's kind of a fraudulent market. And because the settlement of the contracts is in cash, there's no risk to selling naked shorts, that is, an uncovered contract. When you sell a contract in the gold silver market, it's a promise to deliver the amount of gold or silver in the contract. But the people selling those contracts don't have any gold or silver to deliver. And they get away with this because the people who buy the contracts don't want gold or silver. either they're speculating on the price and are going to close out their holdings before delivery date, or they're hedge funds who use gold and silver futures in order to manage various performance ratios, like the Sharpe ratio, which has to do with their risk and return ratio. So these contracts are used for managing a position to show that their Sharpe ratio is sound so that they can sell their funds to investors. And they're used by speculators, but nobody, or hardly anybody, not more than 1 or 2% of the contracts ever stand for delivery.
Where does that leave these markets then, Dr. Roberts?
So what this means is that the bullion banks, these are the big banks, the agents of the Federal Reserve in the gold market, Scotia, J.P. Morgan Chase, they are also the institutions that settle the markets, and they have access to the positions of the hedge funds where all the stop loss orders are. So they look at that and they see how those orders are lined up. Then they go print up as many gold or silver futures contracts as they want. They just print them. They haven't got any gold or silver to back them. They print them and then they dump them all at once within the space of a couple of minutes into a market. They'll dump as many contracts as traded the whole previous week. And they usually pick a time when trading is very thin, almost non-existent. So that huge supply of contracts hits the market. Suddenly, down goes the price in the futures market. And as it goes down, it triggers all the stop-loss orders, and that means more selling on top of what the banks just dumped in. And that selling takes the price on down, so then the banks can buy the contracts back below the price at which they dumped them, close out their position, and pocket the difference as profits. Well, that's how they have been able to drive down the gold and silver price, despite the fact that the demand for gold and silver is at all-time highs. And they're able to do this because the price of gold and silver is not determined in the markets where the actual metal trades. It's determined in the futures market where paper contracts, uncovered paper contracts, naked shorts trade that are never settled in gold or silver. The people don't stand for delivery. They close out their positions. So that allows them to increase the supply of gold or the paper representatives of gold. It can cause the supply of that to greatly increase in the futures market, thereby driving down the price. So that's how you can have a situation where the price falls, even for items that the mints can't meet the demand for. And it's obviously crooked, it's obviously illegal, it's manipulation. And it goes on and on, in my opinion, because it serves the policy of the Federal Reserve. You know, the dollar price of gold started exploding with quantitative easing, because everybody said, good heavens, look at the Fed's balance sheet. It's just building and building and building. There's so much creation of new dollars. What could the dollar be worth? There are far more dollars created than goods and services. We better take refuge in gold and silver. And so that started, and the prices were really rising. And then Fed said, hey, look, if the dollar price of gold keeps going up, sooner or later, that's going to affect all of the dollar exchange rates to other currencies. Because you can't have the price of gold rising, but you can't, that is, you can't have the dollar falling in terms of gold and not also fall in terms of euros and Swiss francs and Japanese yen. We have to stop this. And so that's how they stopped it. They have the bullion banks dump all these paper contracts into the market. The huge supply comes in. drives down the price. So we have this anomaly that wherever you look, demand for gold and silver are extremely high. The supply of them are constrained, and yet the price is falling. This is a total impossibility in economics. It completely contradicts the law of supply and demand, which is the basis of all economics. So the only possible explanation is it's rigged, and as far as I'm concerned, it's not possible that the authorities don't know that. So that's what the article is about.
Dr. Roberts, let me ask you this. Here we are far along now into this crisis that's been happening in the Ukraine. I think you've written about the fact that the rebels, the people claim are Russian supplied, could have destroyed the Ukrainian army numerous times, but the saga still lives on. What's going to happen there, and what about Washington's position against Russia? Where are we?
We're in scary times because the neoconservative ideology, which rules American foreign policy and military policy, says that the first objective of American foreign policy is to prevent the rise of Russia. And so if that's your first objective, then you have to prevent Russia's rise. In other words, you're committed to war, because if you can't do it with sanctions, or you can't do it by causing a coup in Ukraine, you know, Ukraine was part of Russia for a couple of centuries. The Ukraine's been part of Russia longer than the United States has existed. It became independent only in the 1990s when Washington insisted and extracted it out of Russia with the Soviet collapse. So they try the coup there. They'll try the same thing in the former Soviet Central Asian republics like Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan. They'll create all this propaganda about Russia's going to attack Poland. Russia's going to attack the Baltics. They'll build up all these military bases, troops, and propaganda, hoping to knuckle Russia under and make them agree to comply with American foreign policy. But they're not going to do it. Russians are not going to comply. And so unless Washington becomes realistic, which I don't think is possible, or the neoconservatives lose their hold. I mean, perhaps if Trump got in there, or Bernie Sanders, maybe they would clean out these people. I don't know that they would, but it's possible. We know for sure that none of the other candidates would. Unless something like that happens, we're on the road to war. And we've talked before, Eric, that the other thing that could save us would be for the Europeans to finally realize that it does not pay them to be such vassals of Washington that they can be lined up into conflict with Russia, because they have nothing to gain from that. And if there is a war, Europe will be completely obliterated. That'll be the first thing that happens. Europe just will disappear off the face of the earth. So possibly the bought and paid for European politicians who get their bagfuls of money from Washington could come to the conclusion that the bagfuls of money aren't worth the death of Europe. And they might say, hey, we've had enough. We're not going along with this. And if they don't go along with it, Washington can't push the issue. It's got to have Europe as an enabler to bring conflict to Russia. So it's not impossible that these people won't see what's happening to them, and the Europeans won't see what's happening to them, and say, hey, no, we're not part of this anymore. This is it. Sanctions are off. We're out of NATO. And then it would all halt. But it's going to take some major thing like that.
Dr. Roberts, let me ask you this. How do you think this will all end? You put out some scenarios, but what do you really expect to happen?
I think that conflict gets out of hand. And Washington is pushing conflict so hard. In fact, Washington takes tremendous risk. Take this Malaysian airliner, MH17. It's obvious that the Russians and the so-called breakaway republics had nothing whatsoever to do with the downing of their airliner. We know this for many reasons, and the most obvious reason is that the report that's supposed to have been issued by the Dutch, who are the principal people investigating this, can't get released because Washington is blocking it. Instead of the report getting released, Washington leaks to the Western media that the report has concluded that Russia shot down the plane, or that these breakaway republics supported by Russia shot down the plane. And so you keep seeing these stories, these leaks. And then the Dutch investigators, they stand up and they refute the leaks. They say, no, we've not made any such conclusion. But the denials don't get the coverage that the accusations get. And so Washington is sort of getting more and more people to think the Russians are involved because they leak what they claim is the report, but they won't allow the report to be released. And now what are they doing? Washington says, now we'll really set the Russians up. What we'll do, we'll get Malaysia to go to the UN and ask for a UN tribunal to investigate. And this will come before the Security Council, and Russia will have to veto it because Russia will know that it's a setup, that it's going to be a show trial of Russia to find them guilty. They know that, so they'll have to veto it. And when they veto it, we can say, see, they're afraid of the truth. They're against justice for the Malaysians, blah, blah, blah. And that's exactly what happened. It's exactly what's happened. So when you see Washington this determined to create an environment based entirely on lies, then you have to assume that the risk of war is extremely great because there's no restraint on Washington. They've no restraint. And I think Washington is making the mistake of interpreting the Russian diplomacy, you know, Putin's diplomacy, as weakness. Because Washington doesn't use diplomacy. It uses coercion. It uses force. It doesn't negotiate. It gives orders. It puts pressure. It puts sanctions. It uses force. And the Russian response has been, let's talk about this. So look, here's our point of view. What's your point of view? How can we come to some sort of resolution of this? And Washington looks at that as weakness. So they're convinced that Russia is weak and won't fight and will eventually back down and be knuckled under. Well, that's a mistake. They will not. So that's how you get wars. You see what I'm saying? It's not, you know, Washington is making all kinds of miscalculations. And they're so used to lying and getting away with it. Look, you remember Saddam Hussein's weapons of mass destruction? Colin Powell, the former four-star general, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the Secretary of State, and he goes to the UN and lies through his teeth? Now, who's ever paid any consequences for that? Nobody. Colin Powell later said, I didn't realize how badly I was being used, and I'm ashamed of it, and I regret it, and it's a blot on my career, but I didn't know the bastards would treat their own Secretary of State that way, giving me all this false information to take to the UN. But the UN has never called Bush or the Bush administration up there or the American ambassador and said, what in the world? How dare you? How dare you? They've never done anything about it. We know for a fact now that Saddam Hussein had no weapons of mass destruction. Even George W. Bush himself has now admitted that. And yet, nothing has been done about the fact that we destroyed an entire country, killed 1 million people, displaced 4 million, all sorts of people, maimed, orphaned, widowed, birth defects everywhere from the ordnance that the Americans used. But nothing happens. There's no consequences. So Washington says, well, we can tell any lie we want, but nobody does anything about it. The idiot Americans believe them. They believe these lies. No matter how many times we tell them lies, and it turns out they're lies, they believe the next one too. Well, that makes a government reckless. It's arrogant, hubris. Well, that's not the way you want to be with the Russians. They're not any. Last 9 months, previously was last November, that the U.S. Mint had to suspend sales of silver coins because it couldn't meet the demand. We know that for the first 5 months of this year, the U.S. Mint had to ration the sales of the coins. And Reuters, the news agency, reported that since the year 2013, the U.S. Mint has had to ration sales of silver eagles 18 months, which is almost the entire period. And we see the same thing in Canada, where Canada had to ration the sales of silver maple leaves, where Canada reports that the sales of their silver and gold maple leaves are very strong and rising. And if we just look at the last quarter in Canada, the sales of their coins were up 8.5% over the previous quarter. We see massive should be high. And yet, what have we seen since, for example, 2011, when the price of gold went over $1,900 an ounce? What we've seen is consistently falling prices for gold and silver for the last 4 years. How can this be? How can prices fall when demand is rising and supply is constrained? Well, in economics, they can't. It's an impossibility. It can't happen. So the only explanation is manipulation. And here's how the manipulation works. The price of gold and silver is not determined in the market where you go and buy the stuff. It's determined in a futures market where paper contracts representing gold and silver are traded, but the contracts are settled in cash. And so it's kind of a fraudulent market. And because the settlement of the contract withdrawals from the GLD gold trust in the United States, we see a massive sales from the Shanghai Gold Exchange. We see that India's imports in the first quarter of this year of silver is up 30%. Wherever you look, you see a massive demand for hands-on gold and silver, for the real stuff. It's everywhere. And yet we know that the mints can't meet this demand. We know that the mines output is falling because, for mysterious reasons, the price is falling. And so the mines can't cover their production cost at the lower price, and they cut back. So here is the mystery for an economist, for the law of supply and demand. We have massive increase in demand, which means the price should be extremely high. We have supply constraints, which means the price is in cash. There's no risk to selling naked shorts, that is, an uncovered contract. When you sell a contract in the gold silver market, it's a promise to deliver the amount of gold or silver in the contract. But the people selling those contracts don't have any gold or silver to deliver. And they get away with this because the people who buy the contracts don't want gold or silver. Either they're speculating on the price and are going to close out their holdings before delivery date, or they're hedge funds who use gold and silver futures in order to manage various performance ratios, like the Sharpe ratio, which has to do with their risk and return ratio. So these contracts are used for managing a position to show that their Sharpe ratio is sound so that they can
put together. You were talking about the mechanics of how the gold market is rigged, etc. Can you talk about that for the global audience, for anyone who may have missed it?
Well, it's I can try. Yes, it's the easiest if you have the article in front of you, Eric, because it shows the supply and demand graphs that prove the point. But what we do know about gold and silver is that the demand for possession of the physical metal, you know, for the actual gold and silver bullion, is extremely high and has been very high for some time and has been growing strongly. We also know that there are supply constraints because we know, for example, that right now, currently, as we talk, the U.S. Mint has had to suspend sales of silver eagles because it can't meet the demand. It can't get enough silver to mint the coins to meet the demand for them. And this is the second time in the last